Good morning, dear students of class 7, and I'm glad to welcome you all to today's zoology class. Today's class is going to be the continuation of chapter 5. What is chapter 5? Chapter 5 is the excretory system, right? In our previous classes, we have studied the parts of the excretory system, the various organs that belong to excretory system, and their detailed structure all we have studied already. In today's class, we are going to learn a topic called as disorders of urinary system. What is today's topic? Disorders of urinary system. Urinary system is again excretory system. So, what is disorder? If something is not in order, if something is not functioning properly, then you can call it as disorder. So, this is the last topic of the lesson called excretory system, and with this the chapter ends. So, what are all the disorders of urinary system we will learn in today's class? So, there are usually two types of disorders in urinary system. The first disorder would be urinary tract infections. What is the first disorder? Urinary tract infections are called as UTI. Simply, they call it as UTI, and it means infections in the excretory system. In your urinary system, you will have some infections. This is first disorder or discomfort of your excretory system. The second disorder is kidney stones. This also you must have heard of. Some of your family members, especially the elders, might have got this, right? It is common these days, kidney stones. So these are two problems usually that happens in your excretory system or urinary system. About these two, we'll be learning in detail in today's class. So first we learn about urinary tract infections. Do you remember this structure, the parts of the urinary system? You should know these parts to interpret where the infection is happening. Okay, I'll teach you side by side. So, urinary tract infection may occur in three important regions. One is the bladder, the second one is the ureter, and the third part is the kidney. Which is the bladder here? The bladder is this one. So, this is the bladder. Then, which is the ureter? Can you see tube-like structures here? This tube is the ureter. So, this is the urinary bladder, and this is the tube is the ureter. And kidney, obviously you know, the pair of kidneys which is bean shaped are the kidneys. So, urinary infections can happen either in this bladder or in this ureter, that is the tube-like structure, or in the kidneys. Clear? Then, one more concept is urinary infections are common in women than in men, because the genital areas, that is the excretory system itself, is designed in such a way, the physical structure of a woman is in such a way that it is easily prone to infections. Okay, so that's why, that's the reason it is more common in women. Then what may be the causes for infection? When all can you get infection? Actually, in your intestine, there is an organism called as E. coli. What is it? E. coli. It is the name of a bacteria. Where can you find this bacteria? You can find this bacteria in your intestine. All of us have this bacteria called as E. coli in our intestine. Clear? So, this E. coli, which is in the intestine, sometimes it comes out of your body. When it comes out of your body, see, when we pass out our waste through the anus, which is the pathway through which we pass out the excretory products, that is the solid food materials, which is a waste, is passed out through a organ called as anus, right? So, where is the anus? So, this is urinary bladder, this is urethra. After this, you will be having rectum and anus. So, the opening through which waste materials, that is the solid waste materials, are passed out is called the anus, right? So in the anus, sometimes this E. coli can occur. How it occurs? When you pass out the waste, the E. coli can also come along with the waste materials. Okay, so after passing out the stools in the morning, that is after excreting in the morning, when it is not cleaned properly, when the anus is not washed thoroughly with the soap, all what happens, there will be some E. coli sticking on to the anus. Clear? So if there are E. coli in the anus, sometimes what will happen? No, it will go into the urinary tract. Actually, this is the way, right? From the kidney, when urine or other waste products has to come out, how it will come out? It will come to the ureter, then it will enter into the urinary bladder through the urethra, then out of the anus, all it will go out. So whenever there is E. coli in the anus, it will try to enter into your urinary system, that is through the opposite direction it will try to enter until the kidney it can enter. Okay, so the infection we have already studied, it can happen either in ureter, in kidney or in bladder. So when there is a E. coli in the anus, it can enter into the either the urinary bladder, or further if it moves upwards, it can enter into the ureter, or even it can reach the kidneys if the infection is going to be so severe. Clear? So the E. coli from the anus can enter into the urinary tract, that is either to the urinary bladder, ureter or kidneys, and it will cause infection. The kidney may be even infected. So this is the cause for infections. Next, we learn about the symptoms of infection. How will you know that you have urinary tract infection? What are all the symptoms? The first symptom is pain in the pelvis. Where is your pelvic region? Your hip region is the pelvic region. So there will be pain in the pelvis, and also there will be burning sensation during urination. So whenever a person urinates, if he is having urinary tract infection, he will have a burning sensation during urination, and also the color of the urine and the odor of the urine differ. There will be a very bad smell with people who are having urinary tract infection, and the urgency to urinate will be more. Like the person with urinary infection will feel to urinate very frequently, and also he cannot hold on the urine for a longer time. That is urgency to urinate. How can urinary tract infections be prevented? We'll learn next. What are the prevention methods? As I always tell you, always keep yourself clean. Your hygienic practices should be good, which means once you pass out your stools or excrete waste products, you have to clean your genitals well with soap so that there is no more bacteria left on your anus. Okay, so keep yourself clean, and also drink more water. So what is the relationship between urinary tract infections and water? When you go to a doctor, no, the doctor will advise to drink more water. What is actually happening? See, when you drink more water, you will pass more urine. When you pass more urine, if bacteria is sticking on to some urinary parts, no, it will be flushed out with the urine. So when the urine flows out through the urinary tract, the bacteria also will be washed away, will be flushed away along with the urine. So that's why doctor advises you to drink more water whenever there is urinary tract infection. So that's how it can be prevented. And this is treatment method. Actually, giving antibiotics is a treatment method. Usually, simple means of prevention or remedial measure is just by drinking so much of water. Within 1 or 2 days, you'll be okay. But sometimes, even it is not cured, even if you drink so much of water, then you can go for antibiotics. You can take antibiotics to get completely cured from the UTI or urinary tract infections. So the next one what we are going to learn is about the kidney stones. See, this is the picture of the kidney stones. See, this size what I have shown, no, it is almost like this size. okay? So we do not have this much big stones in our kidney, never, nobody has, okay? So this is only to show you clearly I have made it in a bigger size. Actually the stones are very very small, only these size stones you can find in reality, okay? So just for your for you to see clearly I have made in bigger sizes, okay? So what are kidney stones? You must have heard people are telling that some person is suffering from kidney stone, all these, it is so common these days, right? So actually the kidney filters the blood. You have already studied in our previous classes the function of a kidney is to filter the blood. What is present in the blood and what is being filtered? Suppose if there is so much of water exists in your blood, it will filter the water. And also if there are excess minerals or salts in your blood also, the kidney will filter, right? So when a person consumes so much of minerals, or when a person consumes excess of calcium, or when a person consumes excess of oxalic acid, see we are not taking calcium and eating directly, right? From where you get these all calcium and minerals? The food what we eat will have these minerals and salts. Sometimes it may be in excess. Of course calcium is very good, you need them for your bone growth and also for the development of teeth, all you need calcium, right? But sometimes when it is in excess, this calcium and oxalic acid, the next point you can see, calcium oxalate and calcium phosphate, you may wonder, no, what this is made up of, is it a granite all? It might be. I have thought when I was young all, what that stone is made up of. So similarly you must also be having such questions, right? So it is exactly made up of two materials, one is called calcium oxalate and one is called calcium phosphate. So this stone is either a calcium oxalate stone or a calcium phosphate stone. So how it is formed? You eat calcium, you also have food materials which have oxalic acid. So this combination of calcium plus oxalic acid will give calcium oxalate stone. Similarly the combination of phosphate in your food and calcium in your food will give calcium phosphate stones. Clear? So when these minerals or salts are excess in body, and when it happens to combine, because all of us eat but only few of them get stones, it doesn't, even people who drink so much of water also get stones. So it is all a probability. If it happens to, if this combination mix, if calcium and oxalic acid is going to combine in somebody's body, that person only will get stones, not all are getting stones. So if this happens, it will form as a stone. Now the kidney will try to filter the blood, no? When a stone is formed, it just get trapped on the kidney, and then what will happen? It will pass to the ureter. From the kidney, there is a tube, right? That is the ureter. So from the kidney, when the urine tries to pass through the ureter, along with that, the stone also will come through that tube. Which tube? The ureter. Okay. Suppose if the size of the stone is going to be bigger than the ureter, that is the tube, it will get trapped in the tube, it cannot pass down, right? It will be trapped in the tube. If that is going to happen, you will have severe pain because there is a big stone trapped in your urinary passage. Also what will happen, the urine will be blocked because there is a tube and there is a stone in the tube which will not let the urine to pass through the tube. So you will have pain in the tube or in your intestinal region. Then what you can do, you can opt for surgery when the stone size is very big, and if you have difficulty in passing the urine, in that condition only doctors will suggest for surgery, which will give a relief. Okay, some more concepts about kidney stones. What causes kidney stones? What causes insufficient water intake and mineral or calcium diet concentration high in your diet? See, people who drink more water, usually they don't get stones because the minerals are mostly dissolved in the water, okay? But when you take in very little of water, there will be excess minerals, or the concentration of the minerals what you take will be high. Only during that time chances of forming stones is more, okay? So always try to consume less amount of calcium or minerals in your diet. And then what are the symptoms that a person has kidney stone? How will a person know that he is having kidney stone? He will have pain during urination, and also the urine will be having a foul smell. That is, it will smell bad, and also the urine is not clear, it is cloudy or it is turbid in nature. Usually it is clear, but whenever a person has stones, it is a symptom that the urine is cloudy. And how can you prevent stones? A person generally has to drink 8 to 10 glasses of water and should reduce the amount of salt what he or she takes in. Take less salts, not only the sodium chloride or table salt what we are adding, but generally the other salts also, like sodium, potassium, all we take, no? Just check the level of concentration to be low when you take in. And then there is a topic called as kidney failure. This also we hear, no, for many people, that there is kidney failure. How can you define this kidney failure? You can define kidney failure as decline in the kidney function. Decline means decrease in the kidney function. What is the function of kidney? The function of kidney is to filter the blood, right? So whenever the kidney is not doing this function, it has lost the ability to filter the blood, that time you can call it as kidney failure. A decline in the kidney function, the function of the kidney, then you can call it as kidney failure. What can all result in failure of the kidney? The first reason is infections. So usually for mild infections also it is okay. Within few days you will be okay, but sometimes if the infection is going to be too severe, it will spread throughout the kidney and it will damage the kidney. In that case, it will result in kidney failure. And one more cause is injury. Suppose if a person meets with an accident and his kidney is hit badly by something, okay, and if there is physical damage, which means the kidney itself is damaged because of some injury or something, and then also the kidney will not function properly, no? So that time also you can call it as kidney failure. And also illness, when a person is very sick, sometimes the function of the kidney may stop, so that may also result in kidney failure. So what are the causes for kidney failure? Either infections or injuries or illness can result in kidney failure. How can you make this okay when there is kidney failure? There are two treatment methods. One is called dialysis method and the next one is called kidney transplantation method. So what are the two methods by which kidney failure can be rectified? One is called dialysis method and the next method is called kidney transplantation. In the upcoming slides, you are going to learn about these two. See here, this is a machine, okay. What machine have you seen? This machine? No, right? I have also not seen, I have seen only in picture. So this machine is called a dialyzer or a artificial kidney. What is this? This is called dialyzer or artificial kidney. Why it is called artificial kidney? Because this machine will do the function of the kidney. What is the function of the kidney? The function of the kidney is to filter the blood, right? So a person whose kidney has failed, the doctor will prescribe for undergoing dialysis method, usually for 10 days once or 2 weeks once, all the person will go, because your body will produce many waste, no? It is not the food what you eat and you excrete out, that is different. Other than that, your cells also will undergo metabolism and it will also produce waste. You eat and you produce waste, your cells undergo metabolism, that also produce waste. Where they all go, ultimately they all land up in the blood. Everything is dumped in the blood. So suppose if a person's kidney is not functioning properly, if the person's kidney cannot filter the blood, what will happen? The blood will be full of toxic material and excess of water, because his kidney is not functioning, right? So at that case, what the doctor will, it is a medical procedure. Dialysis is actually a medical procedure. We don't do at home, it is done in hospitals. That's why it is called medical procedure. I told you already, it is a machine which is called as artificial kidney or dialyzer, what they will do is they will take the blood. Suppose if this is the patient, this man's kidney is not working. Okay, so they will take the blood from this man and give it to this artificial kidney, that is the dialyzer. What this dialyzer will do is it will remove excess water from his blood and excess toxins from his blood. I told you, when a person's kidney doesn't function, his blood is dumped with toxins, right? So that toxins is removed by this machine, and then what will happen, the pure blood will be given back to the person again. So this machine will filter the blood, it will remove the toxins and excess water, and the pure blood is given back to the patient's body. Now the patient's body, that is the blood, will not have any toxin or excess water. Again after a few days he has to do the same procedure because his kidney has already failed, right? So throughout his lifetime he is expected to undergo the process of dialysis. So one more remedy for kidney failure is kidney transplantation. What is transplantation? Entirely he can change the damaged kidney with the, he can replace the damaged kidney with the new healthy kidney. But what, who he needs? He needs a donor. Who is a donor? A donor is somebody who has a healthy kidney, and the recipient, the patient is called the recipient whose kidney has failed. Okay, so for transplantation there is one donor needed, and the recipient is receiving that kidney from the donor. Actually all of us have a pair of kidneys, right? We have two kidneys, and even we can survive with one kidney. It is possible to survive with one kidney. So even if a person donates one kidney to his relative or somebody else, that person can also, the donor can also live for long. Okay, so in this kidney transplantation method, by surgery the kidney is removed from the donor, that is from the healthy person, and given to the recipient. The healthy kidney, the person who has, he is the donor, and the diseased kidney or the failed kidney, the person who has, is called the recipient. So by surgery he can cut, the doctor will remove the kidney from the healthy person and give it to the recipient, so that the expectancy is increased. What is expectancy? Expectancy means his lifespan, or the time, the period, how much he can live can be increased. So this is all about the disorders of the urinary system and how it can be corrected. So for today's homework, what you are going to do is, in your next class you will have an online test, so prepare for that. The portions will be from page number 89 to 95. So what you are going to do, read these pages thoroughly. I'm not going to ask you question answers or essay type questions. You will read the lesson thoroughly, okay? Because only multiple choice questions or fill in the blanks type of questions I'll be asking for that. You cannot just click anything. You have to read thoroughly. Every term you have to memorize, and you have to understand the concepts also. Okay, so prepare well for your test. A worksheet also in 1 or 2 days I'll be adding in your group. So that is all for today's class, and until I meet you in your next class, you all take care and bye bye.